Father God, I thank you again for the opportunity to come together to worship you on this lovely sunny morning. Lord, whatever the weather, you are worthy of our worship. You are worthy of our praise because of who you are. And we pray this morning, Lord, that as we come together, each one of us will gently lift you on high from our hearts, Lord, and that we will hear from you and receive from you and be drawn closer to you. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. So we go. I'm going to turn my hearing aids now before Jan cuts me. Could you hear me, Sam?
Yes.
Good. Okay. So we're going to start with a hymn and then flow on from that into another song. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. And I've been warned that I'm not to slow it down. I always get my instructions, you know.
Thank you.
can't see yourself on the screen anymore.
No, I was just making sure. Because I always do my read through for my own Bible, which
is good. No, that's exactly what I was just saying. That
making sure that I'm on the right bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the reading this morning is taken from the first letter to Timothy, chapter 6, verses 6 to 16. But godliness with commitment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. But you, man of God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the sight of God, who gives life to everything, and of Jesus Christ, who while testifying before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, I charge you to keep this command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which God will bring about in his own time. God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone is immortal and who gives in unapproachable light, whom no one has seen or can see. To him be honour and might forever. Amen.
We're going to sing Fight the Fight, and I thought the words were in there, so that's why we're doing this one.
Say something about
I was just starting with the last verse there, faith not more fear.
his arms are near. And Sam last week was saying, have you watched Songs of Praise? I don't know if anybody else watched Songs of Praise, but you watch it every week, don't you?
I do.
And he said, oh, Britain was on. So I thought, oh, I'll watch Songs of Praise. Well, we do watch it.
Quite a bit
after. And she has a little testimony whereby, when she's going through a really difficult time in her life, she went to the cupboard and got out all the tablets that were there. And she was feeling pretty ropey and everything. And she got these tablets, and suddenly there was a man in white stood next to her, and she just felt all this peace, and she knew what she'd got to do to get out of the situation. And that made me think, we've been to see Anne Lund this week, and it reminded me of the testimony she used to give when we used to meet in the ladies' meeting in the ladies' Bible study. And years ago, when I think they were living in York at the time, she was in a really nasty accident, a car accident, where she dropped some children off at school and was driving back. And it was very bad. It was the cause of her knee problems and everything. And she had to, I think she had to be cut out and everything. But while she was waiting for the ambulance, she said a man in white held her hand and said, don't worry, it's going to be all right. And when the ambulance came eventually and cut her out, she said, oh, where's the man? And they said, well, isn't a man. You know, the man in white, he was dressed in white, where is he? And they'd never seen him. And during my Bible reading this week, I was reading in Hebrews, and first in Hebrews 1, verse 14, you want to get it, Jim? Can you do it? No, you don't have to. It says, something like, are not angels ministering spirits sent to help those who are, can you find it? I can't remember, just offhand. And God, as his faith not more dear, his arms are near. And we must remember that God does send his angels to be with us when things are bad. And they're not always people. It says they're spirits. Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation? And sometimes they do appear in a manly form or whatever to us. And at other times, I mean, I have the testimony, I've given it on other occasions, I won't, but I heard, I'm finishing in a minute, I heard a voice telling me exactly what to do, and had I not done it, my children would probably not be here now. And I believe that was an angel. It was a voice that came from outside of me and told me. And if you've not heard that testimony, I'll tell you some other time, but let's get on. But faith not more fear, his arms are near. Thank you.
Can I read you a third-time prayer?
Yeah, come and hear a bit, Sam, if you don't mind. Just come. I'm trying to, be more obedient than Janice. I should have stuck with the original scripture for today.
Oh, right. Just bear with me if I make one or two mistakes. I wish I'd got the confidence that many of us
have. You're doing great. Bless you.
Right. Heavenly Father, will you thanks for the beauty of creation and the peace and calm it brings. Please guide us to find you in all things, wherever we are on life's journey. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
That was our prayer before she gave a final hymn, which I'd love to.
Well.
If we can do it, dear Lord and Father of mankind. That was her final hymn.
Yeah.
If we can do it.
We'll do it later then, sir.
Yes, we'll pick that up.
We'll pick that up in a bit.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. So, Talking about angels, I'll just leave that scripture up for a moment. Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to those who will inherit salvation? So as Jan was saying, if angels are ministering spirits, then they're fundamentally a spirit that have been there in the heavenly realms and sometimes appear on earth, yet in a bodily form, and different people have seen angels in different ways. Sometimes they appear as warriors. And people have this idea of angelic and almost sort of intermingle them with fairies on top of the Christmas tree. But that isn't the sort of picture of angels that we see in the Bible. And it's interesting that in the Bible, whenever an angel appears, the first thing they say is, don't be afraid. Yeah, which tends to make you think that if the first thing they have to say is don't be afraid, that the natural reaction to looking at them is to be afraid. But that's not always the case. I wanted to just share something else that came to mind about a situation where I believe an agent was involved. I can't be absolutely certain. But Ken, our oldest son, when he went off to university, it has to be said, we've been through quite a difficult time in church with relationships between the leaders in the church we were in, and we were kind of in the middle of all this, and meetings used to happen in our house, and he was well aware of all this that was going on and had his own perspective on this. And he went off to university in a place where he was kind of thinking he wasn't going to bother with church anymore. And anyway, in the first session at the university, there was a kind of welcome session, and they'd arranged them all in alphabetical order, just given them a place in alphabetical order. And next to him, there was another lad with the name Lion, not very common, but there was another lad with the name Lion. And this lad, they got talking, and this lad said to him, I'm going to go and play football with the Christian University Christian Fellowship this afternoon. Do you fancy coming? Well, Ken's desire to play football over Ken's desire to have nothing to do with Christians. Yeah. And he went along with him to play football with the Christian Fellowship this afternoon, and met there somebody, a guy called John, who's now the pastor of one of the big churches in Nottingham, but was very much a kind of mentor to Ken, who took him under his wing and really helped him through some healing in where he was with his faith and so on. So that's all interesting, except that when he went, this other person there, and was never ever seen again. Okay, so on the horse, yeah. There was no record of him ever having existed as a person, and it just seemed, and we can't be certain, but it seemed that God had sent a messenger just at that point to pick up Ken and take him in his journey, encouraging his spiritual life, which was anyway. So. Perhaps angels can also appear as a young man starting university as well. They can appear in whatever form is needed for the effect that they're there to have as a spiritual force. But as I say, I can't be absolutely certain, but we could, you know, Ken said there was just no trace of this person, of the person having existed. So let's move on to talking about the passage that Lynn read to us. That fight, the good fight. I always remember people joking that was a good wedding hymn. But,
are you all right over there, David?
There's plenty of room. There's another seat here. You're good. Did you have a good holiday?
Yes,
of course. So, Paul is charging Timothy, in the letter to Timothy, Paul is talking to Timothy as somebody who's going to be taking on an increasing responsibility in the leadership of the early church. And very much, Timothy is somebody who has been raised up into that role, and Paul is equipping him for the role that he's going to do, and he teaches him all sorts of things about leadership and to appoint leaders and so on. And he starts off, and Lynn didn't read this bit. I decided in the end to go back a bit before the passage that we read. That's why you don't recognise it. Yeah, it's the few verses before the verses that you read to us. So you didn't miss them out. It was just that after passing on the reading to you, in fact, only this morning, I decided to talk about these verses as well. Paul says, these are the things you're to teach and insist on. If anyone teaches otherwise and does not agree to the sound instruction of our Lord Jesus Christ and to godly teaching, they are conceited and understand nothing. Paul's fairly clear in what he's saying, is that the teaching that he's charging Timothy with is teaching that is required and is required for the church down the ages, and that we're supposed to accept that teaching. And as I mentioned the other day, when someone said to Jan she was being arrogant for believing in biblical teaching, as Paul says, when we don't believe in biblical teaching and decide to make up our own mind and come up with our own idea, that's when we're being arrogant and conceited. Not when we do, yeah? And the fact that we have a view that says biblical teaching stands above our own ideas might cause offence to some people, but that's how it is, yeah? But he says they're conceited and understand nothing. And then he describes a syndrome that I've come across quite often in circles. They have an unhealthy interest in controversies and quarrels about words that resolved in envy, strife, malicious talk and evil suspicions, yeah? And people who've been around in church situations know that from time to time, people can break down into unhealthy controversies and quarrels about words, particular words, and the particular details of what words mean. I remember Dave sharing something with Dave Andrews. He has sometimes come and taken services from us, and he said something to me years ago that I regarded as really helpful. I hadn't heard it before he said it to me, and has always stuck with me. He says, when looking at scripture, remember that what's important is clear, and that what's clear is important. So if we want to know what we should focus on, yeah, that we can all find things to find and look at and think, I don't understand this, and how can this be this, and so on. But actually, when we focus on the core and say, what's the basic, what's clear, what's this clearly trying to say, then we find that the other things we don't understand and we can't reconcile around the edge start to come together and reconcile. Whereas when we get ourselves blown off track by looking at things and saying, or, you know, getting into an argument about pieces of detail, and Christians have argued for ages about how the end of the world is going to happen. Well, it's an interesting argument, but as none of us can affect any of it, and the only thing that we need to know is that we need to be ready, and that's clear, then there's no reason to be divided into a great argument about how it's going to happen. We need to focus on being ready for when the end of the world happens, when the Lord comes again, however it happens and whenever he comes, and he makes clear we won't know. People into all sorts of arguments and debates about lots of detail, but and it says they result in envy, strife, malicious talk, evil suspicions, and people will know that at times these conversations in church can descend into malicious talk, and we need to make sure those sort of things never happen. And constant friction between people of corrupt mind who have been robbed of truth and who think that godliness is a means to financial gain. Now, that's an interesting thing, who think that godliness is a means to financial gain. And I have to say, at various times and in various places in my Christian life, I've heard the gospel presented as, if you do this, God will bless you. If you give, you'll get. Now, actually, very often that's true, yeah? But if the reason that we're giving is in order to receive, then we're not really giving. If we're just seeing it as being a sense of, oh, right, okay, God will multiply this. Because very often, God multiplies what we give back in other ways, yeah? But what I do know is that when we give ourselves to God completely, then he looks after us completely and caters for all our needs. And sometimes his understanding of our needs is different from what we thought our needs were, and that what he gives us is what is good for us. And sometimes that isn't in line with what we think we need. But I've lived in I have encountered Christian circles where people would regard the level of God's blessing being measured by the size of the car on the drive. Yeah, and it's a really dangerous line to go down, because God does provide for us. He does provide for our every need, but we're never to look at our faith as a way and a means to get richer. If that's the basis of why we're doing things for faith, so that we get richer, then we've lost the plot somewhere, which is what Paul is saying to Timothy. Sorry, if I press the right key. But godliness with contentment is great gain. Isn't that a lovely thought? That's where Lynn starts. Godliness with contentment is great gain. Now, I found myself thinking, what do I mean by contentment? Because Paul spoke about, I've learned what it is to be content in all circumstances, whether he's in prison, whether he's in liberty, whatever's going on. And in his testimony, he encountered being beat and shipwrecked, just about the most horrific things that can happen to people. And he says, I've learned to be content in all circumstances. And I started to think, yeah, that's a really, you know, that's a wonderful place to come to, is being content in all circumstances. That whatever's going on, however much people are criticising me, however much people are attacking me, I'm confident in who I am in God. I'm peaceful in who I am in God, and I'm content. What Paul wasn't, which we can tell from the way he lived his life, was complacent. Yeah, he was content, but he wasn't complacent. He was extremely driven, as we can see from his missionary journeys. I mean, if you stop and look and say, hang on a minute, how on earth at that time did somebody make the journeys that he did in his life, travelling to all those places with a passion to preach the gospel? His contentment was an inner contentment, not a sense of, well, everything will be all right, I don't need to do anything. It was a contentment that made him able to commit his life completely to serving the Lord's purposes. His contentment with godliness. It wasn't just contentment. There was a sense of, I have to go, I have to take the gospel to everybody, I have to make this good news known, I have to go everywhere that I can. And he was quite clear, you know, that he was called to be single, to leave himself free, to go and travel around and not have the responsibilities at home. And he also made it clear that that was a personal choice and it wasn't something that he laid as a burden on anybody else. So godliness with contentment is great gain. I think if we take nothing else from today, I think just hanging on to the idea of godliness with contentment being something that we all want to have. And I think that contentment is being peaceful with who we are, whatever's happening to us, and be able to be to find that godly peace. Right, okay. I'm still content. Don't know what I did wrong, but okay. It was me rather than it usually is. Yeah, it must have been. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. Isn't that so true? I mean, we were taking a funeral yesterday, and you think whoever, whatever it is, and whatever we have in life, and however important we think we are, and however important we might like to think we are, we all have the same mortality and can take nothing with us. You know, the ancient Egyptians, we know from the pyramids that they used to put all sorts of possessions with them, with the idea that they'd have something for their following life. But we know that we can take nothing with us. And some people, you know, who are considered greatly important, whether for their wishes or for the wishes of other people, have very grandiose funerals with horses and carriages driving, pulling a coffin and a great procession, and the coffin is carried in front of thousands of people, and there's a massive parade, and but still inside is the remains of somebody who's going to be a body that's going to perish. The funeral we had on Friday was rather the opposite extreme of that. They wanted to be buried at Greenhaven, and so the coffin was brought in. Nick, people who know about Greenhaven, the Green Cemetery between Lilbourne, and Nick is happy to do the undertaker services, but you get a very rustic view of undertaker services from Nick. So the coffin arrived in the back of a van, was taken out and wheeled up the drive, by which they wanted to do, by the family, but there was a tire coming off the trolley that Nick brought along. And what was lovely was they all said this was what Mum and Dad wanted. They both wanted this sort of funeral that was simple, and nobody was upset by the fact that it was just a practical thing of, oh, do we just need to do this and carry that? And, you know, and it doesn't matter whether we have the grandiose setup or the simple rustic setup that was there for Frank on Friday. In the end, we take nothing with us. We come to the end, and what's in the coffin is our remains. And when we are, you know, if we are people of faith, we go to join the Lord, we don't need anything with us. There's nothing that we have here that would add any value to what is coming next. There's absolutely nothing more that we need than to know that we're going to go and we're going to be in His presence and in heaven with Him. And the things that seem important here will be of little consequence when we get there. I remember a story of, I heard jokes, the Indians love to tell jokes, my Indian Christian friends, of a bishop from Kerala. So there were a lot of Christians and in the state of Kerala in South India, because it's believed that Thomas went to South India himself right back in the day. So Christianity has been in India much longer than it's been in the UK and Europe, even though some Indians persecute Christians saying they're following a foreign religion, yet they actually, Christianity went to India long before it came to us. And there are churches in South India that were founded following on from that early apostolic visits way back 2,000 years ago. Anyway, a bishop from Kerala arrived at the pearly gates, and Peter looks at the list and said, I'm sorry, you're not on, you're going to the other place. And he said, well, what do you mean? He said, I just came up and I followed a taxi driver. And the taxi driver, you let him in. And you're not letting me in. I'm a bishop from Kerala. He was a taxi driver. And Peter says to him, you see, it's the effect you had on people. When he drove, people prayed. When you preached, people slept. Anyway, that's not the basis of, just to be clear, that wasn't a doctrinal statement. Just a joke. And I've managed to push myself back to the beginning of this as well. It says, those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Now, very often, that verse gets misquoted, and people say money is the root of all evil, yeah? But the scripture doesn't say money is the root of all evil. It says it's the love of money that is the root of all kinds of evil. And we know how true that is in our lives, don't we? I mean, if we look at the life of our society, how much crime is associated with people trying to get rich quickly? How many people end up being murdered? How many wars have been fought really over possession and wealth? How many people groups have been subjected through history because people have wanted to go come and conquer them and take their wealth away from them? But the love of money, the desire to get richer, is a root of all kinds of evil. And so Paul is saying to Timothy, those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. So if our lives are focused on how do we get richer, then we're open to being tempted in all sorts of ways. And yet if our focus is how do we get closer to God, then we have something different. And then he says, some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. And we can see that for anybody, and in a sense it's a little bit different talking to a group of people of our demographic, let me say, when people have perhaps, you reappreciate much more, don't you, when you come to later stages of life, that the things that are important in life are not really the material possessions that you have. And that those, you know, you look and say, those aren't the things that make me happy. And in fact, you know, it tends to be the case that as we get a little bit older, all of a sudden they become a burden. And that what we've got is a house that's too big to look after. And that was the PA, rather than anything else. All we've got is, you know, the things that we have seem a burden because we can't look after them anymore, and they become something that weigh us down rather than something that we cherish. But our system kind of depends on motivating people to want to get rich as being the goal, as the way of energizing people to do jobs better, to do things and to be ambitious. So it's very difficult, isn't it? And you know, I often think about it, and they've regulated it a bit now, but you used to watch television early in the morning and it was like a bombardment of toy adverts and how to make your child discontent, yeah? Because they were just advert after advert about things that they might want to have, and the children would be watching, can I have one of these? Can I have one of those? And some parents, in a sense, for parents who have the resources to buy them, it's sort of okay, and then they make a judgment and say, well, actually, that would be good. But for people who can't afford it, very often feeling under incredible pressure to buy things to please their children. Advertisements, you know, things are all designed to make us want something we haven't got, haven't we? Because the economy depends on that, on us all wanting more. And there's this tension between where we live. But the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. And when we get distracted with money, we can wander from the faith and bring upon ourselves many grief. But Paul says to Timothy, you man of God, and I believe this is what he would be saying to all of us, flee from all of this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance and gentleness. Aren't those wonderful things to pursue? Don't be focused on other things. Just focus on pursuing these things. Righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Interesting to see endurance in there, isn't it? You think of that might also be interpreted in other ways. Patience, you know, that some people have interpreted as patience as well. But I think endurance is a really good, really helpful interpretation there. That the stickability, yes, and living a godly life requires stickability, being able to go on through the times of difficulty that we encounter. And then he says, fight the good fight of the faith. So we can tell that this contentment that he speaks about, coming back to where we start about being content, this content isn't a passive content. It's not a, I can't be bothered type of content. It's an active, this is who I am. Fight the good fight of the faith. It's an active thing. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. And I'm pretty sure that Paul would have been talking here about Timothy's baptism and so on, when he was baptized in front of people. We don't know precisely what he was talking about. And in the sight of God, who gives life to everything, and of Christ Jesus, who, while testifying before Pontius Pilate, made the good confession. Interesting that Paul holds up as almost a supreme example, Jesus' testimony about who he was, just in the face of, if he'd said something different, he might not have been crucified. But Jesus hung on to the truth of who he was and spoke in front of Pontius Pilate. He made that good, clear confession. And Paul goes on to say to Timothy, I charge you to keep this command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which God will bring about in his own time. We spoke about that at one of the controversies that people argue about. Well, we know, and we can look for the signs, and we know it's getting closer, and we know that by definition we're in the end times, we're in the church era, but we don't know how long this goes on for. Jesus says that even he doesn't know when he's going to return again, which God will bring about in his own time. God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light, who no one has seen or can see, to him be honour and might forever. Amen. Isn't that a wonderful encouragement to us as to the direction of our life, as to the things we have to focus on in life? If we just go back a couple of, flee from all this, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Perhaps we can pray. Lord God, we thank you that you came. We thank you that as Jesus, you came and demonstrated to us a life full of righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. And that you showed that the true man is full of those things. The world has all sorts of images about what people ought to be good people. But you showed us that these are the characteristics that you want us to have. And Lord, we pray that when we're distracted by other things, that you would enable us to turn to you, to look to you, and to pursue your righteousness. And Lord, we know we can only grow in that righteousness through the work of your Holy Spirit in us. So we pray, Lord, for more and more of your Holy Spirit work in each one of us to transform us more and more into what you want us to be. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You're gone?
It's gone.
I'm sorry. Don't know why.
Slipped and I grabbed it.
It didn't go. Right. So I encourage people to choose a hymn and come up with a hymn. And sorry, I know. Yeah.
And Psalms chosen, dear Lord and Father of mankind. Could you all sing up loudly because I can't read the words and follow the chords. So,
thank you.
So, over the past, I think, year or so, we've been aware that Vicky, Barbara's daughter-in-law, has a terminal cancer. And Barb messaged Jan this morning to say she wouldn't be here, and that Vicky had died on Friday evening. So,
she said peacefully.
She said, yeah. So, Barbara's son, Greg, the husband is Greg, and obviously we don't know Vicky's family, but at any time losing a child of any age is always particularly difficult. So, Lord, this morning we lift all of that family before you. Lord, we pray for Greg, as although he's expected this, Lord, as he deals with the grief of losing Vicky, Lord. And we pray for all of Vicky's family, we don't know at all. And for Barb and Keith, who we do know, Lord. And we pray that through all of this, they might know your still small voice of calm and your peace, the peace that passes all understanding. Lord, we don't understand why some of us live very long lives and some of us live very much shorter lives, but we know we have to trust in you and place ourselves into your hands and know that you are God and you are Lord of Lords and King of Kings. You're all these things that we've read about this morning, and you are the one who provides comfort to those who mourn. And so we pray for your comfort for that family at the moment, Lord. And as we think about people grieving, we pray for Flo and her family following the loss of Norman. And Lord, we pray for the young family in the village, for Jenny's family. Lord, we pray that they will know your peace and your strength and your comfort. Lord, for the other young girl who comes to youth drop-in, who's lost her mum in the last few months, Lord, we pray for her as well. We just lift them before you. And we pray that as your people, Lord, we may know what to do, if there's something we can do to bring comfort and help. That we're called to comfort others with the comfort that you have given. Just give us the wisdom to know how to respond. Make us not afraid to respond at the right time, Lord. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, we pray as well now for Al, Trisha's husband, as he's now receiving the treatment that Lord, we pray for him, and we pray for Tricia and for Olivia. Lord, we pray for that family. Lord, we pray that the treatment might be effective against Alan's cancer, Lord. You know everything about this situation so much better than us. So we entrust that family completely into your hands. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we continue to pray for Lexi and for the rest of Sam's family who are going through health problems at the moment. Just please be with them, Lord. May Lexi in particular her, just know your presence with her as she comes to know you, Lord. And I also pray for Janet and for Kathleen. I just give them to you. And other people in the village who are suffering, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
And Lord, your word says that there would be wars and rumours of wars and things that would get worse as we approach your return. And when we look around us, we see the evidence of that in the world. But Lord, we pray, and because you've commanded us to, Lord, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We pray that there might be peace in that region, Lord, a godly peace. And Lord, we pray for governments and all in authority. Lord, that you will guide governments, whether governments that we agree with and support or governments that we don't, Lord, that nevertheless they are governments that you have allowed to be in place. And we pray that you will guide them into righteous action. We ask in Jesus' name. Is there anything else people would like to raise for prayer this morning?
I was just thinking as I watched the Olympic opening ceremony and listened to some of them speaking, it just seems a pity that some of the ideals that are there, togetherness and love for us all, that people could compete in the Olympics, and it would be wonderful to think that that spirit spill over into lives in all countries, all the time.
Lord, we recognise that all kinds of things arise to make us distrust and not love one another. And that I really believe it's a ploy of the evil one to cause these things to cause us to turn against one another and to distrust and dislike one another. And Lord, we pray that you would give us hearts that are full of love, irrespective of whether of people's background, whatever characteristics, that you would give us your love for each person that we come into contact with, Lord. And Lord, that love might be infectious and something that carries forward. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, Lynn. Shall we say the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Yeah, can I tell you a little story?
Yeah.
Well, I go over to my son's on a Saturday evening, and all the prayers that we all of us have given the next. I was overjoyed to see how She has lifted so much, and I put it there in the prayers that we, when we pray for her, and I was so pleased because she's lifted so much.
Praise the Lord.
And she went away on holiday to Carson, and she didn't want to go. She said, "No, I'm not going, not going." Anyway, since she's come back, it's an inspiration for me.
Praise the Lord.
And I, because all the family have gone to a bit of a picnic today, and I sent a text, said, "I'm going to the chapel to pray for everybody."
Praise the Lord. Bless you, Sam. Thank you.
Sorry, Jim. I've been watching the Olympics like a lot of people have, particularly interested in Adam Peaty, mainly because obviously his talent, but also he did go through a very, very dark time, yeah. Went into a spiral which involved alcohol. And then he was talking to some of the Australian swimmers who were going to a Bible study, and they told him about a pastor who follows the Olympics, and people can go to him and talk to him about their feelings and things. And he met with this, although this person, this pastor, doesn't live in our country, he met up with him in a church in Nottingham.
Right.
So I thought it was an interesting connection to what you'd already said about.
Nottingham, yes. God moves in Nottingham as well as other places.
And he turned to God.
Yeah.
And he says, I read a few bits and pieces about the things that I thought were quite interesting, that society does not have the answers, and that's how he found God. And now he's got, I don't know if amongst his various tattoos,
yes.
He's also got Into the Light. And he said that's a recognition of that there's plenty of darkness and to step out of that into the light. And one of the things he said was that he relies on the church and the people in the community to be a good, to try to be a good person, which he said is, you know, he still finds very hard, but he is changing slowly.
Yeah.
So I just thought, you know, it was just an interesting
excellent. Yeah, he speaks of a very real faith in Jesus, doesn't
yes.
he?
Yeah. Having gone right down. He found Jesus.
And his race is at 8:44 this evening. Just in case.
Because interesting enough, his partner is Gordon Ramsay's daughter. And in the article I read as well, Gordon Ramsay has been a tremendous support to him. But if you've ever seen Gordon Ramsay on television, language and attitudes of people he has sometimes, it's intolerant.
Yeah.
So I thought that was very interesting that he owes a lot of his kind of recovery and coming back and God and everything to Gordon Ramsay's support
interesting.
That the family have given him as well.
Interesting. Well, he's from Uttoxeter, so he lives about 2 miles from where my parents used to live. Yeah, so when we went, the last Olympics, I remember we went into Uttoxeter, and everywhere there were pictures of Adam Peaty. You couldn't move for Adam Peaty pictures because they don't have many celebrities in Uttoxeter. Ushita, as they would call it, if you were from around there.
The television programme, there's something happy always that he. Often given a brief for a programme.
Oh, I see.
And they make the television fit the brief. So very often the people are the night of people, but if the brief is just kind of a scenario or whatever, then they pay up. It's all a big game, really. I'm sure it's a lot
of Go on, Nigel.
I've been holding a testimony about trip on eight to Zimbabwe, and because I went to Warwick University, Council pays go when it was the worst time in Zimbabwe. It was people being shot in queues because they wasted a day and a half of fuel. Police were robbing people for their salary. I mean, it was just lawlessness. And I was blessed because I could speak in two areas of Zimbabwe about what I believe is kingdom economics, and these people didn't know from the British Council that these Christians who all gathered and they didn't know, and it was just amazing. But I went to see a farmer, and this farmer said he'd been attacked 30 times. He had a young family, and his wife had kicked up rough with him because he wanted another child, but God spoke to him. She said, no way in these conditions. Eventually, saw the pastor, they prayed, they had another child. And then he was taken away, his father, now with even more children, into the bush. And this time there were 40 men who were going to kill him. And it was miles from home. And he suddenly said, Lord, if you are here, which I believe you are, either I'm making an understanding, you're going to look after my family, but if not, I need backup now. And these men are just about to kill him. So suddenly they just ran for cover. They just ran as fast as their legs could take them. So eventually he recognised one from a farm some distance away. And he thought he better tell the police that he at least recognised one of these perpetrators. So sure enough, they brought this man and another one from that farm, from a neighbouring farm, to come and see him. And his family were all there on the farmstead. And this little girl ran out and hugged these men around the legs. And the father's going, oh, my goodness. The little girl's just in love. You know, just And suddenly, his little family came out with some orange on a tray to give to these two guys that tried to kill Daddy. And these men hold this orange and they're shaking. There's no orange left. Half the orange is gone in their glasses. And suddenly the police are saying, look, hang on, we've come here for you to say that you're sorry and then we're going to deal with you. But do not get worried at this moment. And they said, have you any idea, they shouted, the protection this man has? And then they went, what on earth are you talking about? He didn't understand what they're talking about. He said, when we started to go for him, and we did, there were 40 angels, one for each of us. And they were huge, with great flaming swords. And they took the whole of these 40 to run for their lives. Now these guys are saying, be careful, this man's protection. And this was then through the whole region, because of other farmers that were being attacked. I think sometimes in the darkness, the darker a country gets, then as we come to God, it becomes more evident, as it did in Israel in the sort of Six-Day War and this sort of thing. They were seeing angels protecting Israel in those days against the invading countries. So the worse it gets, the darker it gets, one could say, the more it becomes evident in the darkness that there is a huge protection. Yeah. And that was a testimony I was given by this farmer. Isn't that lovely?
Yeah.
40. 40, one for each of these guys.
Yeah.
Amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
And he never saw it.
They said he'd be very afraid.
Yeah.
They were all petrified. They couldn't even look at this man because they knew he was on his side.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, thank you. Moving on to our notices, it's wonderful to hear the testimony, it's wonderful. I have the Bible study on Wednesday. Next Sunday is a sharing meeting, so it won't be on Zoom, because it's not very practical to do it that way, and Sophie's going to coordinate that for us in some way. If you all turn, it'll be very open, that's right.
Very open.
Yeah. So please pray about what to share and bring to encourage one another in your walk. Yeah. And then
it could be a hymn or choose a hymn or something like that. You don't have to talk if you don't want to.
Is Sophie's asking, is Jean here?
Yes, okay.
You don't mind doing a bit of tinkling occasionally, do you? No. We've been.
Otherwise, I'll come up with a second option.
Yeah. It's okay. So because we're away at a wedding on Saturday and staying over in Cambridge over Saturday night, but we'll have communion the following week on the 11th, if that's okay with everyone. Well, we'll have it whether it's not okay. That's what we'll do. And then our church meeting is a week tomorrow, the 5th. Last week I put up about a Macmillan coffee morning that we might discuss at the church meeting. I'm just put it on here again because in the few days since, Alexia and Joe Parker have announced, which is great, that they're doing a Macmillan coffee morning on the 10th of August. So thinking about doing it in September, so I was thinking it's probably something we should think about for November kind of time frame. We can still do it, but we don't want to be doing it at the same time or close to there. So pick it up again later. So, okay. Right. So then, yeah, looking ahead, we've got our joint service at the Village Hall on the 8th of September, which will soon be upon us, and the Family Day on the 21st of September. Right, shall we sing Holy Spirit, Living Breath of God? Is that all right? Well, you have that. And there's something different. Was somebody singing something in their heart that's different from that? Okay.
Therefore, go and make disciples.